The second speaker of the session is Xavier Gómez Mont, and he's going to speak about the introduction to the dynamics of the Holomorphic Foliation.
Okay, thank you very much. I can also be the organizers, and I will repeat a little bit what I said last time, because there is this Russian saying I love very much, which says that repetition is the mother of learning. So, and also I like to put in this picture, which I found on the internet, which I like very much, because Jack has a beautiful face and a beautiful smile, and then we have this wonderful foliation in his office. So, and you know, I've been meeting the mathematics around Jack since I was a student, of course, when I was in Princeton, reading his characteristic platform was a classical thing, helping to understand these principles of topological methods in algebraic geometry. Then I spent some time studying singularity theory, and of course, mineral fiber there. And nowadays it has extended another something which is called the analytic mineral fiber. That probably Jack doesn't know what it is about, but he's famous with this more at the right of people. And of course, in dynamical systems and in many places, I've gone to different parts of mathematics, and always I find Jack's works, which are clarifying and simple and beautiful. So I thank you very much for your work there. So, as I said yesterday, you know, these objects of mathematics, sometimes they are very simple to define, but they are very complicated and obscure, and they don't give up their secrets immediately. So I think this is the case of holomorphic foliations. I think that our understanding of holomorphic foliations is very scarce up to this moment. And so it's something which is very simple to define, but it's very elusive to describe. And then in the dictionary, elusive is failing to allow for a clear and complete mental grasp. That is something mathematicians like to do, to approach the topic and get a complete mental grasp. And so the definition is a polynomial vector field. It's a little bit more complicated than a rational function. Rational function is the quotient of two polynomials in one variable. And so these are two complex polynomials in two variables. So, you know, it's a little bit more complicated. But of course, one wants to consider the differential equation associated to the vector field. So the vector field gives this description in vectors. And actually, the interesting object is, after we apply Newton's method of solving the differential equation, that produces the phase portrait. So in the phase portrait is this, in this four-dimensional manifold, we have these two-dimensional surfaces, which are embedded in there. They fill up the space, and one wants to understand what I called yesterday this mess, like this mess in Jack's office, and the mess described by the equation. And so the approach I was explaining yesterday, which I got from a infinitesimal type mirror theory, is the following, is that you want to figure out what are the symmetries of the geometric object obtained. So what does this mean? This means that you take a leaf, and then you want to figure out if you can push it over to another leaf, or if the other leaves are completely different from your leaf. So if every leaf is completely different, doing something very different, then you cannot push it over. So this means that the only automorphism that the object has is when you slide over each leaf. So this means that the infinitesimal automorphisms are tangent to the leaf. These are like the stupid automorphisms. You want to figure out if there are some non-trivial automorphisms that really move one leaf to another leaf. Now, so this is phrased, I'm going to remember you, we're in the middle of a meal, and so yesterday we had the entree, which was what I explained, I'm beginning to explain, and then we have this main course, and then we have a new dessert, so please give some space for dessert. So, and then I gave you this example of recapping equation, which perhaps I'm going to skip, and then come back here to this point I was mentioning. So, an infinitesimal automorphism of holomorphic foliation, then, and then I'm going to use, I used yesterday a little carelessly, and then, but thanks to John that he explained all this thing about sheaves. So one important thing when you use sheaves is that when you have a situation where the local situation is trivial, then you try to understand this local situation, and then you have this problem of globalizing the situation. And so sheaf theory is a machine which is constructed to so analyze this problem. Perhaps young people, they don't learn sheaves anymore. It's a mistake. Sheaves are here to stay. It's not something that Rotterdam invented and now Rotterdam is dead, so we can forget about it. He discovered something important and you should not forget. And I think the way I'm presenting this material, it shows you that you can apply it to dynamics. So the thing is, an infinitesimal automorphism of holomorphic foliation is a vector field on the surface, so we have this at the right surface where the foliation is, and in local coordinates where the foliation is smooth, so we can trivialize the foliation, and it's defined by the vector field, the vertical vector field. It's the, I forgot to change this into. So, take a vector field of the following form. AC1 partial with respect to C1 plus B of sequence C2 partial with respect to C2. I'm sorry, this should be a C2. So the fact that this one only depends on the first variable means that you can solve the first equation first. This gives you a movement in the horizontal direction. And then the other one will tell you how the vertical directions move. Once you are moving the horizontal, then how the verticals move. So the important part is the A, the B. Who cares about the B? The A. The A tells you if you're moving from one leaf to the other leaf. If the A is identically zero, then you're just moving vertical. That's the stupid movement. You want to figure out if you can move one leaf to the nearby leaf. Now, since these foliations have transversal conformal structure, if you can move in this one real direction, you multiply by e to the 2 pi a theta, and you move in another direction. So this means that you move it's codimension, complex codimension one, so you're moving in all directions. So this gives a complete uniform. So these terms A1, C1, partial with respect to C1, is what I call a normal vector field. And as John asked, I am not assuming that this is, I'm not assuming that I have a splitting of the tangent bundle and the direct sum of the normal bundle plus. No. The normal bundle is not embedded in the tangent bundle, so it's just an abstract bundle. So these terms over here, and these guys, then, are functions which are constant along the leaves with values in the normal direction. The normal bundle has a flat connection along the leaves. And that's why this is possible. And then when you do this, you can take partial of A with respect to C1 bar. And then this becomes a Beltrami. Excuse me? Yeah, this is partial with respect to C2. I'm sorry, I'm saying this is a mistake. space, please.
If these coordinates are going to mean that the leaves are vertical.
Yeah.
So doesn't that mean the vector field needs to be vertical?
Yeah, no, no. So the vector field that defines the foliation is the X would be vertical. So this would be partial with respect to C2. But this is another vector field, which is related to the defining vector field. And so you take trivializing coordinates for the vector field defining the foliation, and so this looks like vertical, it's partial with respect to C2. And then any vector field which has this form is an infinitesimal, local infinitesimal automorphism of the object.
So this is changing.
This is changing the leaves from one leaf to the other. But this, you can do this locally. Of course, locally, given any reasonably differentiable A, gives you a movement.
I'm sorry,
now, the problem is, can you globalize the A? So this, you do it in local coordinates. So in local coordinates, the set of A's is a module of functions over the ring of functions which are locally constant on the leaves. Locally, there is no problem. The problem is global. Can you obtain a global normal vector field? So that's the problem. So if you can, then this means that your foliation has some symmetries. And then if there are none, then it means that there are no symmetries, okay? But then, as I will explain again in a second, using these quasi-conformal maps, even if there are no vector fields, then this means that there are no measurable invariant Beltrami coefficients, which now is measurable, so it's giving you something in the measurable category, which is very easy to construct measurable things. So anyway, this is the definition of an infinitesimal automorphism, and then I introduce these shapes. So this shape means that locally, no problem. The trick is globally. Now, you want to figure out if they are globally going to extend. So this is functions which are measurable, which are constant along the leaves. Functions which are continuous and constant along the leaves. Functions which are holomorphic and constant along the leaves. You can define these shapes. So it's a specific kind of function that you're considering locally at every point. And then you can do the same thing for the normal bundle. And so you take functions which are holomorphic, sections of the normal bundle which are holomorphic, and these ones are important. So these are functions which are sections of the normal bundle which are continuous, but which have distributional derivatives in L2 such that B bar of sigma is essentially bounded. This is important for infinitesimal type Müller theory. So you consider these are shapes. They are locally defined. And then you take the vector space of global sections. So these are global sections on all the surface, which are sections of the normal bundle, which are continuous, which have these modules of continuity, and which are constant along the leaves. This is some vector space.
How are you able to make B bar sigma essentially bounded?
So that's locally essentially bounded.
Locally essentially bounded.
So here, then you consider these are the global sections of sections of the normal bundle, which are constant along the leaves. And so there is a dichotomy. Either there are none, so if there are none, then there are none. No symmetries. If there are some, then at some point, since these are continuous, so they're continuous, so then this is my definition of what Fatou and Julia said. So the set of points X in M in such a way that there exists an X such that X of X is different from zero, I put that in the Fatou component. So this means that these points, I am going to be able to move the leaf to nearby leaves in all directions. So the foliation near that leaf is homogeneous. And then the complement is this junior set, which is the set of points. And thank you for now, I corrected the mistake I had last time. So this is the set of points where all the sections vanish. So that's the set of points where you don't have this kind of symmetries. And then you define and then the theorem was the following, no? So let F be a holomorphic. Now I do have some hypothesis. I'm not saying that this is a theorem which is valid, because some people complain that I was ignoring the singularities in the statement. I'm including them, and I mentioned that these Poincare type singularities, how you deal with them, you either do blowing ups or you make a small perturbation. So, and this theorem applies to many, but not to all. Of course, to describe it, a theorem that says something about all might be very difficult. To say something about the generic one is simpler. So let F be a holomorphic foliation with Poincare singularities, compact complex surface F, and then Fk be the restriction of the foliation to some connected component Fk of the Fatou set. So I'm assuming here that there are some symmetries, and I'm taking a connected component of these symmetries. Then if you restrict the foliation to that open set, then there are three kinds, as it happens for rational functions. There are the wandering components where the leaves are closed, and then the leaf space is a finite Riemann surface, and this is done by just copying Alford's finite theorem. Then there are these semi-wandering components, which is the equivalent to having these Hermann rings or single disks. And then there are these other dense components. And so there is this classification using this description which I gave before. Now, very important. I think this is the important. The other thing is interesting, this theorem, but this is the one which I like best, is this map. See, because here is fire, this is dynamite, because, let me explain. In here, you have sections which are constant along the leaves, they are measurable sections of this bundle, okay, measurable. So this means, in particular, that you can define something in one piece, and then in the other piece put zero, no compatibility condition, because they are measured. On the other hand, you have these guys over here, which are these infinitesimal automorphisms that which I mentioned, which are continuous. So these have a problem when you glue them on the boundary, if you are going to do something in the boundary. Now, the important fact, which comes from the cohomological computation, is that the kernel and the co-kernel of these maps are finite dimensional vector spaces, because this is an elliptic operator. It's an elliptic operator because you're acting the derivative along the leaves and in the transversal d bar. So it's an elliptic operator. So kernel and co-kernel finite dimension. And so this has the implication that either both spaces are finite dimensional or both spaces are infinite dimensional. So now, if both spaces are infinite dimensional, then this means that you have these symmetries. You have many symmetries, so you have these Fatou components. Now, if they are finite dimensional, then this gives an ergodicity property of the foliation. Because if you take a section, if you take two things which are linearly independent over here, and you take the quotient, you get a function which is constant along the leaves. And so this is splitting the foliation into pieces. So this means that so if this is finite dimensional, this gives you a ergodicity property of the foliation. So I think this is, any question about this? It was remembering the first course, the soup. Image?
Well, these are differentials. So you can take the multiplying cofactor, you can take the norm, and it's one, because it's DC, DC bar divided over DC. Subnorm. Global subnorm. Right. Yeah. So. Let's say this part is really like copied from infinitesimal black mirror theory. So it's exactly the same kind of. So this is infinitesimal. So let's say that's an assertion which has to be proved. No. So the assertion that has to be proved is that this map, putting appropriate norms in both spaces, the map has closed image of finite codimension, and the kernel is finite dimension. So this is fundamental for black mirror theory. For finite dimensional, for
surface S is compact.
Yeah, here the manifold is compact. Yeah, the manifold is compact. And actually the way to deal with the singularities, with these Poincare-type singularities, is that they are coming in transversely at the singularities. So you take a small ball, you remove the ball, you take two copies, and then you glue. And then you obtain something which is transversely holomorphic, which has no singularities. Then you do the argument, and then you do things which are invariant under the involution. So there are some stupid tricks that you can do to get the result. So that is now to pass to the main course. Then I mentioned that we need some new ingredients, which probably are typical for people which come from dynamical systems, but people which have background in rational functions probably. Not so. One of them is the geodesic flow on compact hyperbolic surfaces. So let's see a compact Riemann surface of genus G bigger than or equal to 2, provided with its hyperbolic metric, obtained from the Poincare metric on the unit disk and the uniformization theorem. Let T1 of C be the unit tangent bundle to the Riemann surface. I'm sorry, this tangent to the curve, to the C. So the geodesic flow in the tangent bundle to the Riemann surface, and you have a new B measure, which is hyperbolic metric on the Riemann surface and hard measure on the units on the unit tangent vectors, and it is B invariant. And I made a horrible mistake. I agree. I said it was for Heinz-Hoff, but not in Eberhard-Hoff storage. Thank you very much for pointing this out. So this is the theorem of Hoff, which say that the geodesic flow is ergodic for almost any initial vector. The geodesic starting at tangent to that vector equidistributes itself according to the Liouville measure. And so this means that if you take a vector flow along the geodesic at time t, you push the Lebesgue measure on the interval 0t, and so this is a measure supported on the Riemann surface of length t. So this is a probability measure, and so when you make the length of the geodesic go to infinity, you tend to Liouville. It's a beautiful, fantastic theorem, because in principle you could think you are on this surface and you say, if I travel in this direction, I'm going to go and visit Australia and whatever. And if I go in this other direction, I'm going to go to Japan and whatever. No. And what this says is that it doesn't matter in which direction you go, you're going to see the same thing. And as I mentioned you, there is something which I think is very, very, very important here. So this is not saying that all the geodesics are traveling and doing the same thing. No. So the thing is the following. So you have the surface here. So you have the unit tangent bundle to S, and you take some region, you take a vector, you parameterize, you take big zero of d, and then you figure out how many times, which time you're passing in here. And so this gives some intervals. To know the geodesic means to know which are the intervals of time that you're passing through this region. But if what you do is you add up these times, so you forget when you're passing. You just remember how long you stay there. Look at the difference. Doesn't matter when you pass. And then it turns out that things which are very different now become the same. So in that sense, we have to have eyes to see this. You don't follow like this. So you don't follow the other guy. It's not that everybody is stupidly marching all in the same direction, doing the same. No, things are very different. But if you do this, then the time spent in this region is the proportional volume of the thing. Wonderful property, non-trivial property. You know, when I realized this, I said, gee, this is mathematics. God exists. You know,
if you're thinking about going to Japan in every direction, that assumes Earth is negatively curved, right?
Yeah, when, so this is a hyperbolic metric.
Yes. You were talking about
Oh, well, yeah, right. I'm sorry, S is equal to C, because the S was a surface and then C is a curve, and we have this problem of in algebraic geometry that curves are surfaces. And so C is equal to S, you know. One always thinks that the audience is in an intelligent audience. Right, so I'm sorry about that. No, so this is one theorem that we are going to apply. See, in foliation theory, we have, it's a beautiful play word to work, because we don't only have this transverse holomorphic dynamics that I explained in a moment. So in some sense, the orbits themselves, so in the case of rational maps, you have the complete orbit that also has some structure. But here, the complete orbit is a Riemann surface. And not only a Riemann surface, it's a hyperbolic Riemann surface, so it has this geodesic flow. So in that sense, when you say move, I think, you know, for us humans, we're used to moving one direction. So if time was two-directional, we would say where to go, no? And so what this, what I'm going to explain means the following thing. We're going to follow the following strategy. You put in the tangent vector, unit tangent vectors, and then you flow by geodesics, and then you use this kind of Hopf theorem to realize that you have some ergodicity properties due to the hyperbolicity of the flow along the foliation, and this gives you the measures. And so, magically, this mess, which is the foliation, has a finite number of measures, which is capturing the statistics of the foliation. And so that's the kind of result that we are aiming at. So one result is this Hopf theorem. Now, another beautiful result that also, you know, when I understood it, because, you know, first you listen to something and you don't understand, and then you have to think about it and think about it, and suddenly you understand, and you say, wow, this is really very impressive. So this is Oseledek theorem. I think it's a wonderful theorem, too. And so it says the following. So let mu be an ergodic invariant measure of a dynamical system, and see a multiplicative cocycle. So a multiplicative cocycle is a function which goes from the manifold times R to the matrix, which satisfies this property with respect to the flow. So this is called multiplicative cocycle. Of the dynamical system, here actually I think phi can be even a measurable dynamical system, and m does not have to be compact. So you have this multiplicative co-cycle, but you need that this log of the norm and log of the inverse are L1 function, are L1 with respect to the measure. Then it claims that for mu all x, each non-zero vector like this has a limit, and it assumes, depending on u but not on x, on mu, I'm sorry, but not up to n different values, these are the Lyapunov exponents. Further, if lambda 1, lambda n are different, are the different limits, then these subspaces are depend measurable on the parameter, and you have a precise limit for vectors lying in one place and the other. This is the fact of the existence of Lyapunov exponents. The first time I ever heard of Lyapunov exponents was thanks to Alberto Berkowski, which gave a lecture when he was just coming back from Brown or IPA. I didn't understand them, but so this is the existence of Lyapunov exponents. And so this we're going to use this in a moment. And so let me now go back to these recurrent foliations. I'm going to do first the case of recurrent foliations where these measures will be a direct application of Celedec theorem. And the recent result I have with Christian Bonatti and Matilde Martinez is to extend this result not for recurrent foliations, but for more general foliations. Instead of using Celedec theorem, we use partial hyperbolic dynamics. And so, but first I'll explain the meaning of the statement using this specific kind of foliation, which are recurrent foliations. So let's see me a compact Riemann surface and of genus G bigger than or equal to 2, and take a representation of the fundamental group into PSL2C. And then you take the suspension of the representation is a compact complex surface F rho with a holomorphic map, which is a CP1 bundle over C, which has a foliation, which is transverse to the fibers, whose monodromy is rho. So let me draw a picture of this. So you are given a representation from the fundamental group into PSL2C. So you take the universal cover of the Riemann surface and you take cross P1, and then you act on it on the first factor pi1 using a universal cover, and on P1 using the representation, and what you get is some surface with a map into the curve which has fibers P1, so you get a fiber bundle with fibers P1. So this looks like this. Here you have the curve, here you have these fibers, and now you have a foliation which is transverse to the fibers, and if you here go in a loop, then when you take this and you see you follow the leaves going into the, then you get the corresponding representation. So you construct the foliation, you construct the space, which is just a fiber bundle over the Riemann surface with fiber P1, which has a foliation which is transverse to the fibers, and the monodromy of the foliation is exactly given by the foliation, by the representation. So this is, it gives you a holomorphic foliation in so now let T1C be the unit tangent bundle to the Riemann surface, and consider the representation. So you map the fundamental group of this unit tangent bundle, this three-dimensional manifold into C, to the fundamental group. So you get a representation, and you suspend this representation, and now you get a five-dimensional manifold, repeating the same procedure. You get a five-dimensional manifold with a map, which is a CP1 bundle, which has a foliation, but now the foliation has three-dimensional leaves. So you increase the dimension by one, and so you have a five-dimensional manifold with a foliation of three dimensions, and the foliation is transverse to the fibers of this. Now, the thing is that the new foliation, its leaves are the unit tangent bundles of the previous one. And then, as you know, the geodesic flow does not live on the surface. It lives on the unit tangent bundle of the surface. So the foliated geodesic flow does not live on the algebraic surface. It lives on a five-dimensional real surface, which is the unit tangent bundle to the leaves of the foliation. That's where they. So we constructed this five-dimensional manifold and row, which has a flow. This is the flow is hyperbolic flow along the leaves. Now, as you know, the hyperbolic the hyperbolicity of the geodesic flow means the following. So you have this direction going on the flow, and then you have one direction which is contracting and another direction which is expanding. So this means that some geodesics are coming in and some are going away. So you have this hyperbolicity property. So we put on the leaves of the foliation in the five-dimensional manifold, in the surface, the foliated Poincare metric. So this means you just pull back the metric from the Riemann surface to the leaves. So this F rho is a foliation in a four-dimensional manifold. And we consider the geodesic flow on the Riemann surface and the foliated geodesic flow above. So this is a flow on the five-dimensional manifold, which is lying above the flow downstairs. Now, clearly, this is a multiplicative co-cycle according to the definition I gave. Because it is the fibers here are this P1, you have these spheres. And so the question here is, what are the foliated geodesics doing? Where are they going? Where are they coming from? And in some sense, what if we want to marry Hopf's ergodicity theorem with the representation. So how do you mix these two? So if we project down the geodesic, so if we take a geodesic in a leaf, it's going in like this, no? But if you project it down, it's being uniformly distributed downstairs. And then if you take another direction in another leaf, then it's doing, you think, something else, and you project it down and it's the same. And then you start wondering, perhaps above they are also doing the same, perhaps, right? So so the theorem is the following. We obtained with Christian Bonatti and Marcelo Viana in 2003 for this case of competencia. So let rho be a generic representation. So the word generic, what does it mean? This means that as a representation, it does not have an invariant probability in the Riemann sphere. So this means that rho is a representation of the Riemann sphere. So you don't want it to have a common fixed point. If they have a common fixed point, then the Dirac delta at the point, it gives you an invariant probability measure. You don't want it to be a rotation, because then you have this, no invariant probability measure. So this is a generic condition on the set of representations of the fundamental group of a Riemann surface genus bigger than 2. So let rho be a generic representation of the compact surface C of genus G bigger than equal to 2. Then there are probability measures mu plus and mu minus on this five-dimensional manifold, which are positive and negative SRB measures. So SRB measures are what are called mu physical measures. And so these are measures which is the asymptotic statistic of a positive direct measure set of orbits of the flow. So an SRB measure is a measure which is obtained as the statistics of some orbit, but for a set of positive Lebesgue measure of orbits. That's the definition of an SRB measure. So these, there are two measures, probability measures, mu plus and mu minus, which have this property. With full measure basin of attraction, this means that a full set of Lebesgue measure has positive statistics mu plus and negative statistics mu minus. And moreover, these measures are, there are measurable sections, sigma plus and minus, which go from the unit tangent bundle Lopez to this five-dimensional manifold, which are equivariant with respect to both flows. Whoops. And these measures are the push forward of the Liouville measure. So this means that we have sections, we have in this five-dimensional manifold, we have these measures, which are sections of Liouville measure. And so this means that we do get some sort of Hopf theorem. So it's Liouville measure plus this sigma plus and sigma minus. The question is, where do we get the sigma plus and the sigma minus? Of course, from Mosaledec theorem. Mosaledec theorem tells us the sections. The hard part of this argument, I mean, besides using these two theorems, is to show that the Lyapunov exponents are non-zero, because if one of them has to be the inverse of the other, so one has to show that there is one exponent which is non-zero, the thing is ergodic, and so that's the proof. So for the proof is just use the Lebesgue theorem I mentioned, and the hard part is to prove that the Lyapunov exponent is different from zero. And then, now we're going to do the following thing. Now, you might say, I didn't like this five-dimensional manifold. I didn't like how you introduced this extra one-dimensional thing, this direction. So, let P be the map which forgets this these S1 fibers. So this is the four-dimensional manifold, this is the five-dimensional manifold. It's a map which forgets the unit tangent vectors, and these measures that we have up here, this mu plus and mu minus, we push them down. We forget the directions, okay? And then, so we get these measures. First thing, they are the same measure. So this positive and negative asymptotics above, downstairs, there's just one measure. So on the algebraic surface that we have, there exists a unique measure that is new, which has the following statistical properties. So take any sequence of points, in the manifold, and any sequence of real numbers going to infinity, and take the normalized foliated hyperbolic measure on the disks. So take disks on the leaf around the points Pn and radius Rn. Take hyperbolic area restricted there and normalize so that it's a probability measure. And so the thing is that this measure is absorbing all these measures. So if you take big disks on leaves, and every time you take bigger and bigger and bigger disks, but you don't converge in the disk topology, you converge in the measure topology. You put a measure on the thing, and then so you get probability measures, and then the claim is that you have an attractor. There is an attractor. This measure, mu, is an attractor of all these measures, and actually this measure, you can obtain it in another way by using harmonic analysis, that this is Lucy Garnett's. So we're just re-obtaining Lucy's Garnett's harmonic measure and showing that it has this property.
Now you wrote there that you were using the hyperbolic measure on the disks, but surely you're actually using the Euclidean measure on the disks.
The what?
On the disks that you're talking about.
Yeah.
What measure are you using to take for the Euclidean measure?
No. So, So this is a probability measure. So you have this four-dimensional manifold, and you have a measure on a big disk, which is the restriction of the hyperbolic area, and you're thinking of it as a measure on the manifold, and you're taking the limit in this projective manifold, this compact projective surface. No Euclidean nothing.
So what measure are you putting on these big disks?
On this big disk, so you take. So it's just a restriction of the hyperbolic area measure. So
hyperbolic area within the leaf.
So here, you take the unit disk, and then you take a big disk, and then you take hyperbolic area element, and you restrict to this disk, and then you divide by the area of the disk. So this would be normalized hyperbolic.
And this is within the leaves.
So this is just in the disk. And then you have a map which is uniformizing the leaf, and then you push this measure with the map. So you have a probability measure on a leaf, so it's a big disk. You're parameterizing a big disk in a leaf.
So your leaves are hyperbolic.
Yeah, the leaves are hyperbolic because they are covering a compact Riemann surface of genus bigger than or equal to 2. And this case is easy in the sense that the canonical hyperbolic metric that the leaves have is the pullback of the metric downstairs, and so depends infinity transversal. Riccati foliations are simple because they are simple in the sense that the transverse dependence of the hypercanonical hyperbolic metric is real analytic. When you consider other kinds of foliations in such a way that the leaves are all hyperbolic, then of course you want to put the hyperbolic metric on each leaf, but then you have to figure out what the continuity properties in the transverse direction. But there are theorems in this direction. There is Candel's theorems and Brunella's theorems. So there's one. But in this, this is like the simple case. So in this case, okay. So this means that these measures also have these properties, and okay. So now I'm going to explain in just a few words. How much time do I have?
40
minutes. Any question? Question? So so now I'm going to speak about the generalization of this idea for getting Riccati equations. So the context is going to be the following. So we're going to be given the foliation in the compact manifold. Here in this part of the talk, we are not considering foliation with singularities. As I mentioned, of course, the most natural object and the object we want to understand are foliations in CP2 given by vector fields, polynomial vector fields. They have singularities. You cannot avoid the singularities. There are some examples of some varieties which accept foliation that have no singularities. So we are first trying to understand the behavior of the foliation with no singularity, and later on figure out what is the problem with the singularities. The singularities do have a problem in this part just to mention another result we had about Riccati equations. If you remember, in Oscillatec theorem there was this hypothesis about the integrability of the co-cycle, of the co-cycle. So when instead of having a compact Riemann surface, you have a compact Riemann surface with punctures, and then you make the suspension of the representation on the compact Riemann surface with punctures, then the necessary and sufficient condition so that the co-cycle is integrable is that it be a parabolic transformation around the punctures. So there is a restriction on the so to apply this theorem for Riemann surfaces with punctures, there is a restriction on the kind of representation. On every puncture, the map associated to going once around the puncture has to be a parabolic transformation. It has to be like e to the I theta times z. So we do have examples where this does not happen, like for example for ping pong representations where we do still get some limit. And in that case, these Lyapunov exponents tend to be plus infinity and minus infinity. So in that sense, it means that to have finite Lyapunov exponents, then you need this finiteness of the co-cycle. It seems likely that if it's in the case where you don't have this hypothesis, it's not that it oscillates, but actually that you have super convergence. But anyway, so anyway, in this other context, given a foliation in a compact manifold, we're going to say that the vector field x tangent to the foliation, which is hyperbolic on the leaves, is called an f-hyperbolic vector.
What is hyperbolic on the leaves?
So hyperbolic on the leaves means you take the tangent bundle to the leaves, and then you have a splitting of the tangent bundle to the leaves in an unstable, a stable, and the tangent to the flow. So if you don't get a splitting of the tangent bundle of the full manifold, only a splitting of the tangent bundle tangent to the foliation. That's a hyperbolic vector. So this is the example of these foliations I was explaining. This when you have hyperbolic leaves and you take the unit tangent bundle, then you have this geodesic flow. Now in hyperbolic in partially hyperbolic dynamics, they assume the following thing, is that you have a splitting which dominates, so there is some bundles which you don't know, but they dominate, they are dominated by the ones you know. You know that the ones that are expanding, the other ones are not expanding as much as the ones that you are expanding, and the ones which are contracting less than the ones that you are contracting. This is partially hyperbolic. Now, in this sense, this is not a partially hyperbolic because we are not making any assumption on the relation between the holonomy of the foliation. We're not assuming anything about the relation between the Lyapunov exponents of the foliated hyperbolic vector field and the normal exponents to the foliation. No hypothesis. It could be stronger or weaker. We are not making a hypothesis in this direction. So in this sense, a vector field, a foliated hyperbolic vector field then is, oops, go to the dessert. They made the same mistake that John does, no?
Yes.
Okay, so now, a U Gibbs state for X, Fx, is an X invariant probability measure on M, which are absolutely continuous along the leaves of the unstable foliation. So we have this foliation, and then restricted to the foliation, we have stable leaves and unstable leaves. So we have an unstable foliation, which is subordinated to the foliation we have. So we have this foliation, and then we have the flow. You restrict to the flow, and then you have a hyperbolic flow. So. So here's a leaf of the foliation, and then here we would get, so this would be an unstable foliation of a leaf, and here we have the flow going in this, and then we have another leaf, and then we have another. So the unstable foliation of X is a subfoliation of F. So we're going to put some conditions on these. We're going to detect some special measures that we call U Gibbs states, which come from hyperbolic dynamics and partial hyperbolic dynamics. And so they are going to be absolutely continuous along the limits of the unstable foliation of X in F, and have prescribed positive density in each unstable leaf, which are coming from the distant past. That's why they are canonical, because you use this fact that, that they are unstable, and then you detect a special kind of measures, which are called U-Gibbs state. And then the theorem is the following. Is let N be a compact manifold with a transversely conformal foliation. So here we have a transversely conformal foliation, F of class C1, with no transverse invariant measure, endowed with a leafwise C3 hyperbolic metric, and denoted by X the generator of the foliated geodesic flow on the unit tangent bundle to the foliation. So this is a foliation which is transversely conformal and hyperbolic on the leaves, which is more or less what we have in complex foliation. The only thing is that here we're assuming that it's non-singular, so this here does not apply directly to what we're interested in, because we are not handling singularities here. Then the claim is the following, that every ergodic U-Gibbs state for X has negative normal Lyapunov exponent. So, since the foliation is conformal, then you only have one Lyapunov exponent which repeats itself as many times as the codimension of the foliation. So there is only one Lyapunov exponent, and so the claim is that this Lyapunov exponent is negative, and so you have an attractor. Once you have that, that all the Lyapunov exponents are negative, you have an attractor. So every ergodic U-Gibbs state for X has negative normal Lyapunov exponents, and there are only a finite number of ergodic U-Gibbs states. Each of them is an SRB measure, and the union of their basins of attraction has full event measure on the unit tangent bundle of foliation. So this means that we are detecting a finite number of attractors for this kind of foliations going along the hyperbolic flow, and having the hypothesis that the foliation is transversely conformal. To prove this theorem, we use another ingredient, which is a paper of Bertrand de Rouen and Victor Klepczyk, where they prove a similar statement for transversely polymorphic foliation. So we do need to use their result, but they use Brownian motion. Also, Lucy Garnett used Brownian motion. So in this sense, there are two approaches to this kind of problem, which is to use geodesic flow, that's what we're using, to use Brownian motion, that's what the people which are Lucy Garnett and Bertrand de Rouen and Victor Klepczyk are doing. And also there is another approach using pre-subharmonic which is by Siboney, which also obtains and the dynamics. So there are different approaches which are obtaining similar results. And then, so that was the main dish. Now we're passing to the dessert. So let me explain the dessert. So the dessert is the following. So everybody knows this, the Lorentz equation, which is written here. So it's an equation which has polynomial. It's in three variables, so it's not. It doesn't apply what I said right now. And so we have obtained something that we call an observation. It's not a theorem, because no theorem, only an observation, because it's computer simulated. So we put this equation, but consider it in C3, and then let the flow, consider the flow. And so we did the following. So if you take an initial condition in R3, then you get a trap by the Lorentz attractor, no? So this is point number one. A complex, so for the extended complex Lorentz model in C3, there are at least three limit sets. One is a complex Lorentz set, LC in C3, which is locally has the structure of the usual Lorentz limit set times R, where L0 is the classical Lorentz attractor. It is invariant under the Lorentz flow, and its basis of attraction has dimension at least 5, but has dimension less than 6. So this Lorentz attractor is not attracting an open set in C3. That's what we observe. We would give it a general conditions. We never saw that it was captured by the Lorentz attractor, except if we put in real conditions. So we claim, but of course, it has dimension at least 5, because we have the three real dimensions, and then if you compute the Lyapunov exponents, these are the Lyapunov exponents. So this is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So this 0, two zeros, are the tangent to the flow. So you have a 0 tangent to the flow. But also, if you make I times A, the flow, that also has Lyapunov exponent 0. So there are two zeros, then there is two which are positive and two which are negative, and the fact that the Lyapunov exponents are positive and negative is what makes this Lorentz attractor be a strange attractor. Now, we found by simulation that there were two others. The way we did it is that we would take orbits, initial conditions, let the flow go, and compute Lyapunov exponents. And then what we observe is that we obtain, after running the machine a long time, two different kinds of exponents. And so this would mean that they correspond to attractors, which are not the same because they have different Lyapunov exponents. And so one of them has these Lyapunov exponents, 0, 0, and then minus, and minus. And 0, 0, minus, and minus. So these minuses means that they are attractors. 0 is the one tangent to the flow, but then we have another 0, which makes that this is not an attractor, because we have an extra 0 over there, no? And so so the thing we observed was the problem. So here's one of the pictures that we obtained. So we would take a point and then let it flow. And so it started doing wild things, and then after some time it got into a periodic orbit. And we thought we're going to get an attractor. Then we took another point and then we let it go, and then it would again tend to a periodic orbit. But it was not the same periodic orbit, different periodic orbit. And so in this picture, what you're seeing are different periodic orbits which are tending by different initial conditions. And so we obtained two of these, and we knew that they are in different parts of the space. And so we have pictures of them. These are these periodic orbits. But then we wanted to look more carefully and see if they were periodic orbits or not. And then we got these pictures that when we did a more careful numerical simulation, there was this drift. And so it is not a periodic orbit. It looks like a quasi-periodic orbit. And so the question here is the following. Is that you can have something which comes in and comes very close by, but on the same complex leaf or on a different part of the complex leaf. So the question is, if we can move from one point to the other using I times the vector field. So So this means that, you have these surfaces, and then so you have this curve which is looks like a circle, and it almost closes. So it might almost close because there is this shift in this complex one-dimensional thing, or because it's like in a Cantor kind of set and it goes into another one, which is different. So this is the point where we don't know what's the what happened here. So this was the dessert. And I guess that's what I was saying.
Thank you very much for the very dynamic lectures. Are there questions or comments? Hello?
About your remarks that two zeros make it non-attractive because you're a complex situation, so you still, if these two zeros are related to the complex leaf,
yeah, the complex leaf.
So you might still have an attractive which is related to some complex leaf.
Yeah, but let's say that the real flow has, so here I'm considering the real flow associated to the six-dimensional manifold. And so in this one, what we observe are four negative Lyapunov exponents and two zeros. Now the two zeros we expect the zero tangent to the flow, and then we expect another zero because I times the flow also gives us another zero.
Do you expect some attractive affiliated by Riemann surfaces? Because you have two complex negative exponents.
Yeah, well, I think this opens some questions, but we don't answer. So we just observe this funny thing. It seems that these solutions, which are near the real axis, are tending to something which looks like a torus, right? Because we do see that they tend to something that looks like a closed loop. Now, is this a closed loop because it's something like this of a leaf? Or it's like a Cantor kind of structure, and then if we take another initial condition, we don't get this belt, but we get another belt which is further down. And so now the problem is, what do you make out of this observation? Because it's very difficult to see that it closes or it doesn't close. We tried harder to get more control on the numerics. And after doing a lot of control, we still saw the shift. It was drifting. So it seems that we don't know. This is just an observation. So that's why it's a divertimento. No? We don't know.
What numerical scheme were you using?
I'm sorry. I'm not the expert in this numerical thing. It's collaboration with some people.
Because and so they numerical schemes can lead to shift.
Yeah, right. So that's why
my suspicion is that you actually do have a periodic attractor, and that your product, your shift is due to the numerical.
Yeah, perhaps. Sure. We don't know.
More questions or comments? If not, thanks to get again. This session is over, and we will